On behalf of Dean Vince Rougeau of the Law School and of Vlad Prigiu, the director of the Clough Center for the Study of Constitutional Democracy, I'm delighted to have the privilege to introduce Professor Tommie Shelby of African-American and Philosophy at Harvard University. Tommie Shelby is the author of a book that is now a classic, canonical, We Who Are Dark, Philosophical Foundations of Black Solidarity. Some of his articles, such as Justice and Racial Conciliation, Two Visions, Justice Deviance and the Dark Ghetto, Ideology, Racism, and Critical Social Theory, are also classics in the fields where they intervene. But the extraordinary scholarship of Tommie Shelby is not only a matter of the substance of his work, but also of the method. I have learned from Shelby's work for over the years, and one thing that has stood out for me always is how unwilling he is to pay the intellectual sacrifice demanded by sort of tight boundaries between disciplines. So Shelby is a sort of true philosopher, a true intellectual. He doesn't stop where the discipline set the boundaries of the problems he thinks about and he writes about. And as I'm sure you'll see today, whatever his mind touches, he turns on the light on the subject matter. The Clough Distinguished Lecture in Jurisprudence series has had speakers such as Amartya Sen, Jeremy Waldron, Nicola Lacey, Shauna Shiffrin, and that list is remarkable. And Tommie Shelby enriched that list. So without further ado, please help me to welcome Tommie Shelby to Boston College.
So thanks so much for everyone coming to listen to me. Want to thank the Professor Razzo and Purdue for inviting me and the Clough Center for hosting me and being such great hosts. Everything that I'm going to say, let's put it this way. There is a PowerPoint, but if you can't see it, you'll probably be fine. thanks. And if you are in the back and you're having difficulty, there are handouts with the slides. If you prefer that, you can take those. But I figure since you're eating, you probably don't want to have something in your way. So I'm going to talk for about, just so you know, I think about 45 minutes, maybe 50. I know some of you probably have to leave before I finish, but I will do my best to move along. So in previous work, I've argued that the oppressed within a seriously unjust society, and here I was mainly focusing on the ghetto poor in the United States, argue that they do not violate valid civic obligations when they commit crimes or refuse to show respect for the legal order. And I've also argued that the oppressed can be fairly criticized when they fail to fulfill their basic moral duties to others, including their duty to contribute to reforming their society. Now, these claims are about the political ethics of the oppressed. That is, their attempts to explain the principles and values that should guide the oppressed as they respond to their social conditions. And I took up these questions from the standpoint of citizens of an unjust social order, focusing here on how they should view their relations to one another and to the state that illegitimately claims authority over them. But I didn't address how the state should regard and respond to the criminal deviants of the oppressed. And so that's the task for today. If I can make this move along, maybe I can't. Is there a PC user?
anyone feels confident that he or she, would you please?
I don't know why it's not, he told me that I could advance it just with these, but I don't seem to be doing anything. Oh, okay, I just clicked there. Okay, thank you so much. That will work. So my main interest in philosophical theories of criminal punishment is to answer the question, when, if ever, is state punishment justified in a context where the state has failed to secure just background conditions? Or to put it somewhat more broadly, how should a criminal justice system operate in a society that is fundamentally unjust? Now, I'm not here thinking primarily about an unjust criminal justice system, that is, one that treats criminal suspects, defendants, and convicts unfairly, for example, through arbitrary searches, confiscations, disproportionate sentences, wrongful convictions, uneven enforcement, inhumane prison conditions, and so on. The criminal justice system at issue may itself be reasonably impartial and fair, given the content of its public rules and the way those rules are applied and enforced. But the system may operate in a broader social context that's shaped by deep structural injustices, unavoidable poverty, entrenched patterns of discrimination, denial of political liberties, and so on. Now, I'm going to defend the claim that serious injustices in the basic structure of society compromise both the state's authority to punish criminals and its moral standing to condemn crimes within its claimed jurisdiction. But I'm also going to argue that such a state may, if it fulfills certain fairness requirements, justifiably punish some criminal deviants, even some of the crimes of the oppressed. Now, a state is a set of legal institutions that claims authority over a territory, in particular, the right to demand obedience to its laws from those within its territorial jurisdiction. Now, when we assess the legitimacy of a state, we might evaluate it from the standpoint of international relations or from the standpoint of those subject to its laws. The international community may assess a state for its human rights compliance to determine whether, for example, its sovereignty should be respected or whether it should be subject to sanctions or some kind of outside intervention. Those under the rule of a state's laws may evaluate the state on grounds of social justice to determine whether they have an obligation to obey. Now, when I speak of legitimacy here, I'm going to be concerned with the normative status of the relationship between a state and those it claims a right to rule. And I won't be addressing the relations between states or the limits of sovereignty. Now, some political and legal philosophers make a distinction between two types of legitimacy. There's justifiable enforcement legitimacy, and then there's the right to be obeyed legitimacy. Now, the right to use coercion to enforce a rule is different from the claim right to have the rules one lays down obeyed. A state may have the right to enforce laws against, say, murder and rape simply because these are serious wrongs that violate basic moral rights. The duty to comply with these laws arises from one's natural duty to refrain from such reprehensible acts and from the contingent fact that the state is best positioned to maintain order and safety. The right to be obeyed, which we might call legitimate authority, includes the right to impose obligations outside this domain of natural duties. In addition to enforcement rights, legitimate authority includes rights to command and entitlements to obedience. And the commands in question needn't prohibit things that are intrinsically wrong to be authoritative. It's the commands themselves, that is, when they come from the right source under the right conditions, that make noncompliance wrong. To have legitimate authority is to have a special kind of right, a right to demand on pain of penalty that others comply with a command or rule one is issued. It's the right to create obligations for others where none existed previously. Authoritative rules preempt or override reasons for acting contrary to the rule, and they do so not because of the content of the rules, but because of who issued them or the procedure through which they have come about. The subject must obey because of the source of the rules, and not because of the substance of the rules. Now, it's generally agreed that if a state fails to meet at least a minimal standard of justice, it doesn't have the authority to demand compliance with the laws it legislates. And those within the relevant territory have no obligation to obey. In such cases, we say that the state lacks legitimate authority over those it claims to rule. Now, I'm not going to offer a precise normative standard for judging when a society has failed to meet these minimum requirements for legitimate authority. Instead, what I want to do is discuss briefly the kind of standard relevant for such judgments in order to explain the relationship between authority and punishment. So following John Rawls, I think that the relevant kind of standard is reciprocity. The legitimacy of a political order is to be judged by how well it maintains a fair system of social cooperation. So we rightly submit to a state that has legitimate authority over us because it protects our basic liberties and ensures an equitable distribution of the benefits and burdens of economic cooperation. It would violate reciprocity and fair play to take advantage of the freedom and economic benefits made possible by just legal order without accepting the constraints of the law and contributing our fair share to maintaining the material conditions of social life. The authority of law cannot be reduced to the threat to threats and brute force. Legitimate legal authority I view as a part of the normative order of society, just as our basic moral rights and obligations. We should think of the laws of a state with legitimate authority as, if you like, the official promulgation of the rules that should govern the conduct of those within the state's territorial jurisdiction. Law lays down public rules that make explicit what conduct is expected and what conduct will not be tolerated. When a state maintains a just social order, those in a society should willingly submit to its legal demands. As a political community, we expect all members to comply with these rules out of a sense of justice and reciprocity, and not simply out of fear of sanctions. The system of criminal punishment, that is, the state-imposed penalties for serious violations of the law, is part of the coercive order of society. State punishment of criminal deviance, if you like, backs up the legal order. It provides reasonable assurance to law-abiding members of society that criminals will not be allowed to take unfair advantage of their willing compliance with the law. It also provides incentives for compliance to those who refuse to respect legal authority or who might find it difficult, say because of temptation or weakness of will, to conform to the law for moral reasons alone. But our duty to uphold and support the legal order is valid only if the state does a reasonably good job of maintaining a fair system of social cooperation. If it falls below this threshold, then we no longer have a duty to respect its claim to authority. A person's civic obligation to comply with legal demands is contingent on the existence of a reasonably just social order. And it's a duty of justice and simple reciprocity that ground this obligation to obey. However, even if a society exceeds the limits of tolerable injustice, it doesn't follow that the oppressed have no moral duties to one another or to others. The oppressed, just like everybody else, do have natural duties, which are not defined by civic reciprocity and thus aren't invalidated by the existence of an unjust social order. They should refrain from, for example, murder, rape, kidnapping, assault, and so on. And one's duty to not violate others' basic moral rights does not depend on the existence of a just social order, nor is it contingent on others' willing compliance with this duty. One should respect the basic rights of others regardless of whether others conduct themselves similarly, and regardless of whether the state treats everyone fairly and with equal concern. If the authority of law and the duty to obey the law depend on a state satisfying certain, say, minimum standards of social justice, as I've been here suggesting, then we might say that a state that fails to meet these standards lacks legitimate authority to punish disobedience to its laws. But that, I take it, would not entirely settle the question of whether the state could permissibly impose penalties for lawbreaking. the most burdened by the injustices of society may lack an obligation to obey the law, here on reciprocity grounds, but the state that claims legitimate jurisdiction over the territory within which the oppressed live may still retain the right to impose penalties for certain crimes. That is, it may have enforcement legitimacy. In particular, a state or an unjust society could still retain the right to penalize actions that are seriously wrong in themselves. After all, there is a basic moral right to repress actions that seriously threaten our lives, freedom of movement, or physical or material well-being. Indeed, as Daniel Farrell emphasizes, there is a right to intervene, using threats and physical force if necessary, to protect others from unjust attack. But why think that natural persons are the only agents who can exercise this right? Surely a group of persons can collectively exercise it. And if this is so, why not state officials following the criminal justice procedures in an otherwise unjust polity? So under what conditions would it be fair for a state that here lacks legitimate authority to threaten, penalize, neutralize those who engage in unjust aggressive acts? So I'm not going to try to offer a comprehensive list of conditions, but I think certain requirements of fairness stand out as especially important. First, the state would have to publicly announce that it was going to impose penalties for serious crimes and to make clear just what these penalties would be. Without this public warning, offenders could rightly object that they were being denied an opportunity to avoid these repercussions. Second, alleged offenders should have an adequate opportunity to defend themselves against accusations that they have wronged others, and to justify or offer excuses for their actions. Third, the criminal justice system must apply its public rules in a reasonably impartial and even-handed way. Otherwise, there's no semblance of the rule of law, just the arbitrary and capricious threats of a dictator or rogue regime. And finally, the penalties should be humane and no more severe than is needed to deter the unjust conduct in question. Though a state and an unjust society may not have legitimate authority over those it seeks to coerce into compliance with its laws, it may nevertheless have a legitimate enforcement right to compel their compliance with legal requirements that forbid certain serious moral wrongdoing. At a minimum, a state and an unjust society may permissibly penalize prohibited violent actions that are mala in se, wrongs in themselves, and such penalties would be justified by the need to protect people from harmful wrongdoing. So that's mainly by way of background, just some basic distinctions and assumptions for the argument that I'm gonna give you now. So in a just society, a criminal justice system would have more than one social function. Certainly it would be relied upon to keep crimes within tolerable levels, but preventing crime would not be its sole legitimate purpose. It would also provide a political community with fair procedures for determining when its laws have been violated, including, of course, a fair way for those accused of lawbreaking to defend themselves against charges that they violated the law. The criminal justice system is also an institutional mechanism for holding persons accountable for violating laws. It's used to call people to explain, to justify, and to accept responsibility for their criminal acts. In addition to crime prevention, due process, and holding people accountable, a criminal justice system in a just society may publicly condemn acts that have been duly demonstrated to violate the political community's laws against harmful wrongdoing. And what I want to do for the remainder of my talk is to focus on this condemnatory role of criminal justice, of a criminal justice system. And I want to distinguish that condemnatory role from the system's punitive role. Condemnation is the public expression, explicit or implied, of strong moral disapproval. Acts that communicate condemnation are generally reserved for particularly serious forms of wrongdoing, such as unjustified violent acts, many of which are criminalized. Private individuals condemn criminal acts, but so do institutions like the state. Now, there are legitimate reasons for a state to publicly condemn criminal wrongdoing. The state might, for example, seek to reaffirmed the political community's prohibition of the act in light of the transgression. Doing so, I take it, makes explicit that any inference that the state doesn't take such violations seriously would be mistaken. The state might also want to indicate concern and respect for victims of crime. By condemning a crime, the state communicates to victims that it takes their interests seriously and that their grievances against those who wrong them are justified. And the state might also want to convey to the offender that it regards his or her conduct as unacceptable. It's important to communicate condemnation to criminals, and not just to the victim or the broader community, in order to indicate that any subsequent penalty imposed is imposed only because the person has committed here some really grave wrong, and not, say, to make an example of the person, or so as to deter others. The wrongness of the act is why we seek to prevent acts of that type from occurring, and condemning the act is part of our explanation to the criminal for why we are taking such drastic measures, that is, penalizing it, to repress it. However, one purpose of state expressions of condemnation is to publicly disapprove of acts that defy the state's legitimate authority. So in this case, the condemnation is for disobedience to law. A state might also condemn a criminal act for its, say, inherent wrongfulness, or might condemn the actor for his or her blameworthiness, or blameworthy ill will. But these further expressive acts of condemnation should be distinguished, I think, from condemning culpable failures to obey the law. If condemnation of disobedience is to be apt, then the state must have legitimate authority. It must have a right to demand obedience from those within its claimed territorial jurisdiction. A state with enforcement rights but not legitimate authority might rightly condemn violent crimes for their wrongfulness. However, it could not rightly condemn offenders for their disobedience to its laws, as, of course, it's not entitled to their obedience. Now, this way of thinking about the condemnatory function of a criminal justice system shares some common features with what might be called penal expressivism. According to penal expressivism, the justification for punishment is, at least in part, the penal sanctions express or communicate public condemnation of criminal acts. Now, I include in this family of views Joel Feinberg's theory of the expressive function of punishment, R.A. Duff's communication theory of penal sanctions, and Andrew von Hirsch's and Uma Narayan's theory of penal censure. And what I want to do is distinguish the view I'm defending from these three views, and in the process to raise some questions about the plausibility of penal expressivism. Now, I take it that the central problem for penal expressivism is to explain why condemnation of crime requires hard treatment of criminals. Stiff fines, work penalties, imprisonment, deportation, so on. It seems that we should be able to communicate our moral outrage, our message of condemnation, without imposing suffering or deprivation on those who do wrong. Yet Feinberg insists that punishment has symbolic significance. It expresses attitudes of resentment, indignation, and disapproval. He also claims that reprobative symbolism and hard treatment, while distinguishable, of course, for analytical purposes, are never, he thinks, separated in reality. Indeed, he maintains that legal punishment, by definition, involves both hard treatment and condemnation. Now, I don't believe that condemnation and punishment are as inextricably linked, either conceptually or practically, as Feinberg maintains. I certainly agree that a just state should condemn violations of criminal law. It should not abide defiance of legal authority or egregious wrongs. But at what stage in criminal proceedings does or should condemnation occur? And at what exactly should be condemned? And one might think that the state has already condemned the act when it prohibits it through law. The state effectively says, this is wrong and forbidden. But perhaps we can condemn only wrongful acts that are ongoing or have already occurred. And if this is so, then the laws themselves don't condemn acts, but only prohibit or perhaps deter them. I mean, the most we could say is that the state condemns act types through criminal legislation. It's not thereby condemned the particular concrete act of that type, in this case, the wrongful act performed by the offender. However, we might think that the relevant condemnation properly occurs at the time of conviction. That is, once the offender's admission of guilt has been formally accepted, or when the judge or jury renders a verdict of guilt after a trial, rather than, say, at sentencing or during the period when the sentence is being carried out. As conviction is the final public judgment of guilt, I think it would be natural to view it as also expressing condemnation of the legal violation. Now, one could object that while the state, in convicting a criminal, has condemned a criminal act, it has not condemned a particular person who has performed a prohibited act. To do that, it must punish the offender. However, I don't see why it's a legitimate state function to condemn offenders over and above condemning their wrongful acts. Why must the state render a judgment on, say, the wickedness of the criminal? And is the state really best positioned to make such assessments? But even if condemning criminal offenders is a legitimate state function, I don't see why the rituals surrounding conviction couldn't be sufficient. Now, Feinberg insists that not only is penal hard treatment, for example, imprisonment, inseparable from condemnation, but hard treatment itself expresses condemnation. As he famously says, the very walls of his cell condemn the criminal and his prison record becomes a stigma. This doesn't appear to be strictly true, however. What of those who are being merely detained in jails or prisons? They are being held in prison only after being accused or suspected of committing a crime. They haven't been convicted. The final judgment of guilt has not been rendered. So imprisonment itself can't express condemnation. It's more plausible to think that the public judgment of guilt, here say at the end of a trial, expresses condemnation. Of course, if we take this approach, which I'm advocating, we need to explain what's happening at the sentencing phase and during the period when the sentence is being carried out. But this poses no real difficulty. A sentence is a matter of containing dangerous criminals, extracting compensation for harms caused to victims, providing would-be criminals with an incentive to refrain from wrongdoing, or some combination of these things. The sentence just needs to be fair and a reasonably good deterrent or crime control device. We needn't attach any symbolic significance to the sentence itself. Now, Feinberg is led to regard punishment as having symbolic significance because he believes that this expressive function is needed to distinguish punishments, say imprisonment, from mere penalties, like fines. Now, his mistake, I believe, is thinking that the relevant distinction must be found in features of the penalties themselves, rather than in what type of violation the penalties are for. Some penalties are for minor legal failings, like misdemeanors, and some are for serious ones, felonies. While a state with legitimate authority would penalize and disapprove of all lawbreaking, including maybe even parking violations, it will penalize and condemn serious crimes, like, say, murder and rape. However, I see no reason that the condemnation must be somehow encoded in the penalty itself. I suspect that penal expressivism gained some of its plausibility from ambiguity in the word condemnation. It's sometimes said that the state has condemned an offender to prison or to death. Now, this goes beyond saying that the state highly disapproves of the wrongful act, or even of the criminal, to saying that the state has expressed an intention to deprive the criminal of liberty or life, or that the state has already actually taken his or her liberty or life. Now, there's nothing wrong with speaking in this way. I'm not trying to make a point about how to speak English. But I think we need to keep the two sentences of condemnation separate when we're attempting to explain and justify the system of punishment. So for clarity, we might distinguish condemnation, the expression of strong moral disapproval, from damnation, imposing suffering or deprivation on wrongdoers. It would thus be true to say that a state can condemn a criminal's act without damning the criminal to prison, and vice versa. Notice also, we don't damn acts, but actors. So condemning a wrongful act does not imply damning the wrongdoer to suffering. Now, Duff argues that punishment doesn't just have an expressive purpose, but a communicative one. That is, punishment involves reciprocal and rational engagement with the criminal. Its point of justification is not mere condemnation, but moral persuasion. As with other penal expressivist theories, though, Duff does tie communicative purpose to hard treatment, claiming that penal sanctions communicate condemnation. But he insists that these sanctions must also have a forward-looking, but in his case, non-deterrence-based, dimension if they are to be fully justified. So accordingly, for Duff, punishment has three moral goals apart from condemning past wrongdoing: repentance, reform, and reconciliation. Repentance, he claims, requires that the offender take a period of time to reflect on his or her wrongdoing. Part of what a penal sentence accomplishes, then, is providing a criminal offender with the necessary structure for moral reflection and an opportunity to come around to appreciating the need to refrain from such wrongdoing. Now, this forced seclusion also functions as a, if you like, a formal apology to the community for breaking its laws. And once completed, the offender should be forgiven and allowed to join the community as a member and in good standing. By contrast, I view the point of public condemnation of crime as entirely symbolic. Its value is in what it communicates, in this case, moral criticism and disapproval, not in any beneficial consequences that may result from it, either for the criminal or for the society. Such condemnation needn't be justified in terms of how it, say, contributes to moral reform of criminals or to reconciliation of criminals with their fellow citizens. And the condemnation is not expressed through punishment, but through formal conviction. Of course, the guilty person's criminal act deserves condemnation, that is, it merits strong public disapproval. Such a response is not only apt, but I think permissible, but I think it would be a moral failure on our part if we didn't condemn such serious wrongdoing. But this is different from saying that the person deserves prison. And so the position I'm defending here is not a form of retributivism. No doubt the state's public condemnation of crime wouldn't and shouldn't be taken seriously if the state could do something to prevent such wrongs, but didn't. It could justly be accused then of merely paying lip service to the wrongfulness of these acts, or maybe even for tolerating them. But the state could and should show its sincerity and good faith in condemning crime by doing whatever it could to prevent criminal wrongdoing. And it could do this not only by punishing crime, but also by removing or mitigating known causes of crime. Well, the penal expressivists, von Hirsch and Narayan, hold a view that I think is most similar to the one I've been sketching. And I agree with the penal expressivists that the criminal justice system within a just legal order will have expressive dimensions, in particular that it's going to condemn acts of criminal deviance. But I don't think the practice of punishment, that is imposition of penal sanctions for lawbreaking, can be justified solely by appeal to the expressive or communicative function of a criminal justice system. Von Hirsch and Narayan side with Feinberg and Duff in thinking that punishment expresses condemnation, or what they call censure. But they concede that the need to express condemnation of crime is really insufficient to fully justify the hard treatment that criminals typically endure and receive. So in their view, punishment is justified as public condemnation plus incentives to motivate compliance with the law. For example, one can imagine the parties in Rawls's original position, after noting that those they represent might be morally weak, agreeing to establish a set of non-moral incentives, in this case penalties, to encourage themselves to comply with the principles of justice as articulated through law. If the political community should accept the practice of hard treatment as a prudential supplement to the moral reasons for compliance, and this avoids the problem of treating lawbreakers as somehow as enemies of the state or as outside the community or as mere means to promote the common good. And it also avoids the objection to viewing the criminal law as an institution that issues general threats to citizens, that's treating them as non-rational animals need to be somehow manipulated or frightened into obedience to law. So the state isn't threatening us on their view. We, through the penal instruments of the state, are simply giving ourselves an incentive to comply with the laws we've made for ourselves. Now, I deny that the condemnation of crime should be expressed through penal sanctions. However, I don't object to the idea of punishment as prudential incentives to obey the law. When it comes to the forward-looking dimensions of punishment, I wouldn't stop there, though. I think it can be perfectly permissible to threaten would-be criminals with penal sanctions as a way of deterring them from wrongdoing, though I'm not going to argue for that claim here now. Instead, what I want to do is close this part of my discussion by further clarifying why I think it's important to distinguish condemnation from punishment. So I've been so far just loosening you up and keeping these two dimensions apart, but why does it matter? So I reject the retributivist claim that criminals, due to their moral depravity or wickedness, deserve to suffer. But if we hold that punishment necessarily expresses condemnation, and we justify punishment, even in part, by appeal to the need to condemn criminal wrongdoing, then I think it can be rather difficult to deny that retributivism is true. Considering the following three claims. The first, serious wrongdoing deserves public condemnation. Two, condemnation is expressed through hard treatment of wrongdoers. And third, a person who commits a serious wrong deserves hard treatment. Now I affirm one. I think one's true. But I deny three. The three is true. And I'm doing that primarily by denying that two is true. Now, one might argue that three, that is, a person who commits a serious wrong deserves hard treatment, follows from the first two claims, that is, a serious wrongdoing deserves public condemnation, and condemnation is expressed through hard treatment of wrongdoers. However, it's not clear how you can plausibly deny that it does follow. When we say that a person deserves praise or recognition for some achievement, and that prizes or honors are how we express such praise and recognition, then it seems to follow that when a person does some particularly praiseworthy thing, they deserve a prize or honor. The reasoning behind penal expressivism appears to be analogous. And this, of course, is part of the reason why I resist the doctrine. But if we deny two and three, we need some other way to justify hard treatment of criminal offenders. And here I side with those who say that the need to prevent crime is that justification. Now, whatever the correct theory of legitimate authority is, if a state is to will such authority, the society over which it governs must satisfy certain minimal requirements of justice. A state that punishes crime under seriously unjust social conditions can be subject to different types of moral criticism and various forms of legitimate resistance. I want to conclude then by explaining some of the ways that the moral deficiencies of such a state can make it illegitimate for the state to publicly condemn crime, while the state nonetheless retains the right to punish at least some crime. When a society falls below the threshold for tolerable injustice, and its state is responsible for the injustices, for either perpetrating them or not preventing them when it could, the state's right to punish crime is compromised, if not completely undermined. Moreover, lacking the authority to impose obligations through law, it has no moral basis for condemning disobedience to its laws, particularly the disobedience of those unjustly disadvantaged in society. Such a state, if it's not too unjust, may have a right to punish serious and harmful wrongdoing as a defense of those who are not liable to harm. However, it would lack the right to criminalize wrongful acts beyond these most serious ones, and it would lack altogether the moral standing to condemn defiance to legal authority. Perhaps such a state would retain the moral standing to condemn wrongful acts, even the wrongful acts of the oppressed, more on that in a moment. But the state would not be justified in condemning the wrongful acts of the unjustly disadvantaged on grounds of unfairness. That is, given that the state has not maintained an equitable distribution of the benefits and burdens of the cooperative scheme, when the oppressed violate the law, they don't take unfair advantage of the compliance of others. Their acts may be condemnable on other grounds, of course, but not here for lack of civic reciprocity, not on grounds that they fail to meet their civic obligations. However, this is not the only way that a state's moral standing to condemn crime can be compromised or lost. Such standing can be vitiated or absent altogether if the state is complicit in the crimes it would condemn. Victor Tadros explains the complicity criticism well. Such criticism, he argues, depends on the idea that the state participates in or contributes to the wrongdoing it condemns. For instance, poverty engenders crime, and the state may unjustly contribute to impoverished conditions by, say, failing to maintain a just social structure. Insofar as street violence results from, say, resentment toward unjust inequalities, the state shares responsibility for its harmful consequences. It is not, therefore, in a moral position to engage in finger-pointing. A state might also lose its standing to condemn a crime because it engages in the same kinds of wrongs it condemns. Now, this argument is advanced by Duff, who regards a state as lacking the moral standing to condemn an act if the state fails to abide by the values it invokes to condemn that. So the political community, here represented by the state, is not abiding, or at least not fully abiding, by a moral rule it's ostensibly committed to, rules against deceit, theft, unjust violence, unjustified violence, then it doesn't have the standing to condemn those who violate the relevant rule, the corresponding rule. When a state is complicit in the wrongs it punishes, or hypocritically punishes wrongs that it engages in, it lacks the moral standing to condemn these wrongs, and is therefore rightly criticized for these unjustified expressive acts of condemnation. But does it also lack the enforcement right to punish these wrongs? Now, Tadros and Duff think so, because they believe that if the state lacks the moral standing to condemn a crime, then it also lacks the right to hold a criminal accountable for it. That is, he or she isn't answerable to the state, can't be tried by the state, and so on. Tadros, for example, argues that the state cannot act as judge in cases where it bears some responsibility for the crime. Its complicity in these crimes makes it unsuitable to judge those accused of them. Thus, if the state cannot hold criminals accountable for their crimes, it can't permissibly punish them either. Similarly, Duff argues that when a state fails to treat persons in accord with its professed fundamental values, it doesn't have the right to hold them accountable for their alleged failure to abide by those values. And if the state can't hold them accountable, then it can't permissibly punish them. Indeed, Duff thinks that if the state lacks legitimate authority, making it the case that citizens have no obligation to obey the law, then the state cannot permissibly punish any crimes, not even those that are mala in se. Now, I think these are powerful arguments that, if you like the one I've been sketching for you, needs to answer. But I'm not going to try to offer a fully adequate response now, but I do want to briefly point in the direction that I think such a response should go. And I'm going to highlight a serious problem, I think, for Tadros and Duff's view that I don't think I have to face, and that is a plus in my favor. So first, a brief response. So I'm prepared to concede that criminal offenders in a deeply unjust society are not bound to answer to the state for their lawbreaking. So in one sense of accountability, they aren't accountable to the state. That is, they don't have an obligation to explain or defend their actions to the state. However, I believe they can be rightly tried and punished if they have been accused of unjustly attacking another, adequate efforts have been taken to make them aware that such acts would be penalized, they have a fair opportunity to defend themselves against the charge that they have violated the rights of others against violent attack, and finally, the penalty is proportionate to the offense. In short, it seems to me that much will depend on whether the criminal justice system operates in a reasonably impartial and fair way. In many instances, of course, a society that is deeply unjust in other respects will also fail to maintain a fair criminal justice system. And so, perhaps many states that lack legitimate authority will also lack legitimate enforcement rights. Next, let me explain a problem for Tadros and Duff. Now, both recognize that oppressed persons often commit violent acts against others who are also unjustly disadvantaged. In addition, they note that if the state does not punish those who perpetrate these acts, it would be failing to protect some of the most vulnerable in society against violent wrongdoing, therefore compounding the injustice they face. So given their premises, the state in an unjust society confronts a dilemma. Either it can punish those it has no right to punish, or it can fail to protect those it has treated unjustly. So in Tadros' and Duff's accounts, no matter which direction the state takes, it will perpetrate additional injustices, further weakening its claim to legitimacy. Now, we can avoid this dilemma, I think, if we follow the approach I've been sketching, which distinguishes legitimate authority from enforcement rights and separates the ends of punishment from the function of public condemnation. Under conditions of serious injustice, a state's authority to rule and moral standing to condemn crime, are indeed compromised, if not undermined. But enforcement legitimacy, and thus the right to punish at least some crimes, may remain intact. Though a state or an unjust society may lack the moral standing to condemn criminal, to condemn violent crime, say here due to complicity or hypocrisy or lack of authority, it may have an enforcement right to penalize such crime in order to deter and contain it. Justification for this is the need to protect the vulnerable from unjustified harm. A state can sometimes be in a position to provide this protection in a way that is justifiable to those who wrongly threaten others. Though lacking the moral standing to condemn, the state operating under conditions of social injustice should punish only those who have done condemnable acts, that is, acts that merit strong moral disapproval. But these penal sanctions don't express condemnation and may be applied simply as a crime prevention measure. If condemnation and punishment were inseparable, or punishment is merely the vehicle through which we express condemnation for lawbreaking, then punishment under conditions of injustice couldn't be justified, or at least it couldn't be justified fully, since punishment would just be condemnation. Then not only would the state lack the moral standing to condemn violent wrongdoing, it would lack the standing to punish and thus to prevent such wrongdoing, contrary here to the duty to prevent unjustified attacks on others when you can. But if we separate condemnation from lawbreaking, from the penalties for lawbreaking, as I've been arguing we should, then we can explain how punishment can be justified even when authority to punish disobedience to law and a moral standing to condemn crime have both been lost. So a state with enforcement rights, I think, should be seeking to gain full legitimate authority by remedying the injustices in the basic structure of society. Indeed, if it's to preserve its enforcement legitimacy, it should be making a good faith effort to regain the trust and allegiance of the oppressed, as it should not permanently deprive offenders of the public benefits of citizenship, like voting rights and income subsidies, housing assistance, loans for education, unemployment insurance, and so on. Given that the terms of political association are not remotely fair to these persons, it would not be reasonable to revoke privileges of citizenship, as we might, I do underline might, justifiably do under just conditions. Moreover, in addition to working to establish a just basic structure, the state should be making efforts to reconcile with those it's wronged. It should be trying to make amends and to regain legitimacy in their eyes. To achieve these ends, it should institute educational and voluntary rehabilitative programs for those it punishes. And it should aid former prisoners with reintegration back into society, providing, say, skills training, counseling, employment, maybe housing assistance. Since we know that inequality, poverty, and low educational attainment are strongly correlated with, if not causes, of violent street crime, the state needn't rely exclusively on punitive responses to crime. Crime among unjustly disadvantaged could be controlled through the establishment and maintenance of a more just social structure. The losses this would involve, say in the form of taxes or opportunities, wouldn't be unfair to the affluent, I don't think, since some of their advantages are, as it were, ill-gotten gains. That is, they are derived from exploiting a manifestly unfair opportunity structure. Moreover, the unjustly disadvantaged, as equal citizens, are due a fair opportunity structure, so they wouldn't be getting anything they're already entitled to. That's it. Thanks. Can you fill them for me?
Yeah, sure.
Just call. If not,
yeah.
I'll answer.
Yeah, great.
So we have time for a question. Sherry.
Thank you so much for coming here and for your really rich talk. We appreciated it. Here's my question. So you describe a criminal justice system for an unjust state, which has a first phase that determines responsibility for the act, and then a second stage which can't condemn or punish, but can take administrative steps aimed at prevention, for example. And my question is, how is that different from a civil system? It sounds like no criminal justice system left at all, just a civil system that determines, did the person do the act, yes or no? And if so, what steps can we take to prevent this from happening in the future or protect society? So if you take, my question is, if you take out the condemnatory aspect of it, is it a criminal justice system anymore?
Maybe I'm not communicating clearly. So it wouldn't be merely civil, because penalties would be imposed if the person is found to be in violation of the criminalized act.
But the civil system imposed penalties all the time. Parents taking away your kids, some states, debtors' prison, penalties are part of the civil system.
Sure, but I take it in that case, this is. Would be action taken on the part of the victims against the perpetrators rather than the political community in response to the wrong. Isn't that the difference?
Well, take a traffic violation, for example, civil. So there's a stage where it's determined, did the person speed, yes or no, responsible or not responsible? We're not condemning the person. We're just saying, did you do this or not? And then if they're found responsible,
right.
It's civil. So this, your system sounds like that to me?
I mean, I feel like we're arguing over a word, but
civil versus
criminal. I take it that there are certain actions that are serious wrongs and harmful, and that's why we criminalize them and impose sometimes rather severe penalties for those actions, because we regard it as extremely important to prevent them. So when I'm speaking of a criminal justice system, I take it as it's the institutions that are set up to do that work, to do the work of preventing or at least controlling certain serious forms of harmful wrongdoing. So if the thought is, I guess I'm surprised that you would think that the difference between civil and criminal law is that criminal law condemns and civil law doesn't.
Well, like take involuntary civil commitment.
Yeah.
There's some thought someone's a harm to themselves or others, and so they're put in a locked facility. Mm-hmm. Looks like criminal punishment. It has a different purpose, and it's not condemnatory. So I guess what I'm pushing you is, what is it that's distinctive about criminal punishment if it's not the condemnation? What's distinctive about the criminal system if it's not that you condemn?
I guess I'm inclined to say, what do you think turns on that? That is, suppose I say it isn't fundamentally different. What do you think turns on that, other than what we call it? Do you think it matters?
No, I guess I,
Well, I don't say that. I don't say that.
No, I know. That's okay. I don't know how to ask it.
Okay, I guess we're talking past one another. I mean, my point is there are acts that are criminalized, are thought to be particularly serious wrongs perpetrated against against victims or the community at large. We take it that it's particularly important, quite apart from whether the victims themselves think it's important. We think it's important to repress those things. And so we do, and we use the criminal justice system to do so. So if the thought is, if we don't also condemn those violations, then it's not a criminal justice system. I guess I don't see a reason to resist that particularly, unless I see what turns on it, because I'm not sure I do.
Professor Jorge Garcia.
Hi.
Hey. I'll try to be fast. I'm going to suggest 2 points about logical form and see if they can be used to push in a different direction. Right? So, first, if you think of condemnation as a malediction, saying something bad, and then allow that nothing is just bad, it's only bad in some way, then also complicate the distinction that you make between condemning actions, whether act types or particular actions on the one hand, and condemning people on the other. Then it seems to me you could understand condemnation as being a more complex phenomenon in this way, that you guys, right, the society, condemns me for an action, for say my killing Smith, and condemns me as went wrong, bad in a particular way, namely responsible, culpable, answerable. It seems to me once you take that line, then the question is, well, in what way am I going to be made to answer for or to account for, to respond for what I did? And that would seem to suggest something has to happen to me, which is a kind of criticism for my behavior. So I'm not sure that it makes sense to see what's going on here as a kind of, so even, I guess, that there's something to be said for understanding punishment as a kind of condemnation, namely a criticism, malediction against the individual, the agent, as culpable for a particular action. And I think once you've got that, I don't see there's much more to do to justify as legitimate, not necessarily as required, but at least as listed.
Trying to understand the implications. So I'm taking it that then criminal justice system, even in the context of injustice, is, as it were, holding the person accountable. That is, in trying to make a determination of their culpability, trying to make a determination of whether they have violated the law and are responsible for doing it. So that's not in dispute. You want to say that it's what it means to make the person answerable is what?
Well, it's doing something, it's making them pay in some way.
Oh.
I don't see what the relevant response is, the responsibility, the answer is, accountable. If you say,
I see.
Accountable, then don't do anything to me. You see, that's what we criticize sometimes in politics. If somebody says, I'm responsible for this mess up,
right,
they don't lose their job or anything, nothing happens.
Right. What doesn't seem to me, that's, I take it, that's the thing I was trying to deny. But that is that that it follows from a person's culpable wrongdoing that they should suffer. So
what is the proper motive there of making them respond? What is the response?
I mean, part of what we're doing is we're there's a sense in which we're calling them to account by making the determination of that they've actually committed a wrong. Sometimes they accept that they've committed to wrong, and it seems to me that that can be enough that they do. You think not? You're skeptical.
hi, thank you very much for coming, Professor. When you were talking about retributivism, you made these 3 points, and you rejected point number 3, that criminals deserve hard treatment, because you rejected point 2, which was that condemnation is expressed through hard treatment. Now my question is, did you reject point 2 because condemnation is simply not expressed through hard treatment, or are you rejecting it on principles perhaps of it's disproportionate to what is necessary for condemnation to give hard treatment?
Well, I tried to give a few different arguments. And so the first part was to just try to make you skeptical of a very natural thought that the way we express condemnation is through hard treatment or through some posing some kind of deprivation or suffering on the person who's done the wrong. So what I was trying to suggest is that initially was to get you to see that connection is not as conceptually or practically as tight as some people have assumed. So the first part of the argument was to say that. And then I was trying to suggest that we can sometimes be justified in penalizing even when we're not justified in condemning. So that was so the first part argument was to lay out the distinctions for that and to show why you could defend that, why it will be perfectly defensible to the person you're penalizing, while it might not be defensible for you to condemn their act, either because what you're condemning is their disobedience to law and you don't have authority, or because you're condemning their act, but you're either complicit or hypocrite in condemning their act. So the way the argument's supposed to go is to get you to convince you that condemnation and punishment aren't as tightly connected as people think, and to show you why it's implausible to think that it could be that tight once you see the implications in the context of injustice, and once you see the relationship between authority and punishment.
So you're saying that while perhaps you can condemn by doing hard punishment, that does not necessarily mean that hard punishment is what's necessary to condemn. There's lots of other ways to condemn. Perhaps.
Yeah, well, I think that's the central problem for penal expressivism, is that it seems like we could have other conventions and rituals for expressing condemnation other than through sentences. And in fact, we do, I think, have such. That was the thought. So their thought, I take it, is that this is the vehicle through which we express that condemnation, that is through penalizing, and it's just not clear to me why we should take that to be true, and I've tried to give you reasons to think that it's not.
Okay, we have 4 questions. Professor Madoff, the gentleman here, the gentleman there, Mr. Cohen on the back.
Thank
and then
so
we have to stop.
Okay, I'll try to be quick. So I do want to also follow up on that point about the condemnation and whether you can condemn, because I wonder whether sometimes it doesn't have the exact opposite effect. When, like, we often think in the law, somebody will be, well, we've convicted you of the crime, you did it, but you're not going to be charged with any time or time served. In a way, the way the public experiences that is almost not, it's not as a condemnation. We experience it as a vindication that, in fact, the person was doing good things somehow. Sometimes that can happen. I think that can sort of confuse the story.
inner city neighborhood, and are they going to be punished or not? And is it the state's really unfair in all of the ways that it operates, therefore you can't do that. Well, this seems doesn't quite seem right to me, because it seems to me the state is actually lots of different things. And sometimes we could say that the state is representing the interests of the people in that community, and therefore should have its full authority. And the fact that in other parts of the state's existence, it does bad things, I don't know why that should necessarily undermine their authority in that realm.
Fair. Good. So in the first, I take it that you know, there wouldn't be a puzzle here at all, right, if it wasn't there's a natural, if you like, you know, understandable, ubiquitous human response to wrongdoing, and that is that the person should be made to suffer in some way because they did it, if it's a serious enough wrong. I don't deny that impulse. I don't deny that that's the moral sentiments that undergird it. What I deny is that it's correct. That is so sure, of course, people feel cheated or as if justice hadn't been done if someone does wrong and they don't suffer as a result. But I just think that they're just mistaken. That is the sentiment is understandable. We have it, just like we understand when a person, if someone were to kill a member of my family, and if I were to kill them in response, you would understand it. But I take it you think I'd be wrong to do it. The point about the state, I think you're right. It's complicated because these institutions are never really fully distinct, right? Because it's hard to disconnect the legislature from the judiciary, given the judiciary is presumably applying laws, or to separate even in like in our own system the executive, given its primary function to enforce the Constitution and uphold it. So it's hard to fully disentangle these institutions, it seems to me. You could get into the practicalities of like how it is that we come to have these officials that play these roles, how it is that we come to have the police force that we have and who runs that and, you know, and so on and so forth. So while I agree with you, sometimes it does make sense in some cases to distinguish these institutions and the personnel, say, within them and what their intentions might be. I guess I'm inclined to think that it still could be an appropriate response to the state to regard its, here in this case, its legal claims, its claims that you must comply with what we legislate, and to resist to resist that claim under certain conditions, even if you think that the some of these other institutions like the judiciary operates in some ways, at least, you know, partly independently of, say, the legislature. So I guess I'm in agreement about that. Just I'm not sure that condemnation is reinstated as a result of that distinction.
So, when you talk about an unjust society, and you're saying you can't condemn, but you can punish for serious crimes. You keep saying murder and rape. Then do you distinguish between major crimes and, quote, minor crimes, and how do you draw the line, which is serious that it should be punished as opposed in an unjust society, as opposed to maybe not being punished?
Right.
Or do you think the whole judicial system should still be in effect?
So I wasn't trying to draw that line. I was just trying to establish the principle, as it were, right? So I wanted to establish that even on unjust conditions, it can be justified for the state to penalize certain wrongs, taking the easier cases to establish something got ticketed, and some people at least are quite skeptical about whether under these conditions the state could justifiably punish. And I want to say in those cases, I think you can make the case. One might be able to make the case for other things, that is, and for penalizing other things. And I wouldn't want to, but I wasn't trying to draw that line. I just wanted to establish the principle. And of course, and it may be the case that the state will penalize a range of things, and there will be a question about whether, beyond these, say, serious wrongs, and it will be a question for those it claims to rule, though in this case it legitimately claims to rule, about whether they should comply nonetheless, right? That is, even though they don't have an obligation to comply, they might have reasons to comply that have to do with either because of the practical consequences, or because they think that it's important. They think that it's that the state, while unjust, is not irredeemable and can be reformed to be just, and it might make sense to comply with certain things in order to, you know, as it were, support the state's in its self-reform, assuming here the state acting in good faith. Am I being responsive? Partly.
I guess, yeah. I mean, I don't know if it can really be answered, but it seems like...
You know, where to draw the line?
Yeah, but no, I guess it seems like you're saying that just apply to all the different laws. I don't think you really are drawing the line. You're saying you're using those extreme examples just to explain why punishment without condemnation would work.
Yes, that's that was
appropriate.
Right.
But you could say if...
But there can be a bunch of...
lesser crimes is not like, you know, might not universally be condemned.
Sure. I mean, it might be a thing...
There are certain crimes that some people say, it's a minor thing, you know.
Right. And there might be some things that are not... I take it that there might be things that the state criminalizes that there's not a good enough reason to do so. But it does it anyway, and when it's just, we should still comply. We try to change it through democratic process and whatnot. But there might be things that it criminalizes under unjust conditions that it doesn't have any good reason to be criminalizing. I think in that case, we don't have any obligation to comply. That was the thought.
I appreciate the distinctions you're making, but I see them as ideal type kind of analysis. My question is, who is it that's making the judgment as to whether it's a just society or just whatever?
Sure.
Unjust or just? And is it a community? Is it an individual? Is it a group? Is it a segment of a group? Can that segment or group or individual claim, since they argue it's an unjust society or system, not that the laws do not apply to them? Therefore, they don't have to do what the society or system asks of them.
Yes, so I take it any individual within the claims jurisdiction of the state has to make that determination. Now, they can be mistaken, of course. So, I mean, they may judge that their society is seriously unjust, and therefore they don't have an obligation to respect its authority. But they can be wrong.
Who is deciding that?
Well, nobody's deciding it. I mean, it's not that kind of thing, right? I mean, it's not like calling balls and strikes, right? So we each judge whether the society we're a part of or other societies that we might think are in need of reform, whether it's reasonably just or not, and we act accordingly. My point was just that sometimes when people judge that the society they're a part of and that claims and the state claims authority over them, they judge that the society is fundamentally unjust, and they're correct. And when they are correct, things follow from that. That is about the authority of the state to penalize them for disobedience and so on. So, but there's these kinds of moral claims, there's nobody to decide them, like for us. I mean, we decide them.
Well, set of criteria against which a just or unjust society would be evaluated by anyone. And who's, you know, you have, or who, whoever, wherever those criteria come from. And therefore, a judgment can be made regardless of who it is.
Sure.
Yeah?
Well, yeah, I think there are things that justice requires and things that it doesn't. I take it that we all do. We might not agree about what those things are, but I think there's an answer to the question that is about, and philosophers have for a very long time tried to answer it. So if the point is that there might be a lot of disagreement about it, sure. I think that's right.
Mr. Cohen, you have the last question.
I guess just in closing, I was wondering, because a lot of what you talked about, it seems more or less like a description or a response to conditions in the United States, which you more or less get explicit about at the beginning. I guess I just wondered if there were any point in our history, or I guess any other sort of state that you could point to as a state that's would qualify as one that's meets the criteria that you set out as for what would make a just state, or a state that's just enough to legitimize the extent to which it punishes criminal acts?
So the question is there any state in the history of the human race that is reasonably just? Sure, I suspect so. yeah. Well, I mean, is this tendentious? So, but I mean, so I'm kind of avoiding it. But yeah, sure, I think there's some Scandinavian countries, I believe, are reasonably just. But But it requires, to make these judgments with great confidence requires that you know a lot about society, which is usually it's a kind of thing that we do with respect to our own. We make where we have intimate knowledge of how it functions and how it's functioned over time. We do, of course, make judgments about other societies. This is what, at the beginning, I said I wasn't going to speak to, which has to do with whether they are, you know, what some people would say decent or meet human rights, satisfy human rights requirements, because then we think that they're kind of like beyond the pale, as it were, and it might make sense for us to intervene in various ways. But that's a different question. I mean, that question about whether they're satisfying human rights requirements, so that outsiders, it makes sense for them to intervene in various ways and don't have to respect the sovereignty of the state, I think is a different question from the question that a citizen makes about their own society and whether it's reasonably just. So the argument I was giving was meant to be abstract enough to leave open the question of whether, of what particular societies satisfy the requirements of being reasonably just. I have in other writings said things about the U.S. and how I think about it, and it's not quite as unqualified as it's seriously unjust, or falls below the line of tolerable injustice. I say something somewhat more complicated about it, but I don't want to try to like sketch that whole picture now. But I do believe, of course, that I do believe that the United States is unjust. Whether it falls below the tolerable levels, I think is a more complicated question.
Please join me in thanking Professor.